I was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord. Are you glad this morning? Oh, come on, if you're glad, you need to stand on your feet and give God a hand clap of praise for allowing us to assemble once again in this Bethel spot. Oh, he is good. This morning, I'm going to open us up from Psalm 100 for our call to worship, where it tells us to make a joyful shout to the Lord. All ye lands, serve the Lord how? With gladness. Come before his presence how? With singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Oh, y'all are on it. Into his courts with praise. Yes, sir. Be thankful to him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures through all generations. To God be the glory. Father, we come thanking you now for another opportunity to place our feast inside of your holy gates, Father. We come now thanking you for this day that you have made, and we rejoice in it, Father. We come worshiping you in spirit and truth, Father, thanking you for all that you've done for us, doing for us, and will do for us. And right now, we just come with thanksgiving in our hearts and praise on our lips, Father. And we just thank you for your son. We thank you for your spirit. And we pray right now, all we do in this worship service will bring you glory. It is in Jesus' name that we pray and ask it all. Amen. Amen. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. We bring you greetings this morning here from the Mount at 707 Arista Road in Bowman, South Carolina. It looks a little different. It is not Pastor Gopher. We give honor to the angel of this house in his absence as he takes a well-deserved vacation. Amen. I think y'all can agree with that. So we praise him and Sister Gopher right now for all that they've done and pray that they're getting some rest and relaxation. But we welcome you here, all of those on Facebook and YouTube, and those that are inside the sanctuary. We're so glad that we are able to honor God with our presence in some safe form and fashion. So right now, we're going to get going. We're going to have our praise teams. Y'all receive them with a hand clap of praise right now. They're going to open us up with praise and worship. Followed by that, we're going to have the invocation from Deacon Fogle and another song from the praise and worship team, and I will return with our scripture. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
I just want to praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you.
Once more again, you become on this day.
Mm-hmm.
First, we want to give you praise and honor for all that you do, Heavenly.
Yes, Father.
Even though, God, we come out to worship you in spirit and in truth.
Yes.
We thank you, dear God, for all those who are here right now in your presence.
Yes, Father.
Fill them, O God, with your Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Move in a mighty way.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
And Father God, we pray now that you look upon this sanctuary, Heavenly Father. On Minister Rick Zeno,
Heaven.
Yes. God, we feel him before Heavenly Father.
Yes.
When he break bread this morning.
Thank you, Father.
Yeah, some woman reach out and cry, I yield. What must I do to be
saved?
We pray for this magnificent praise team, Heavenly Father. Continue to fill them, O God, with your spirit, Heavenly Father.
Yes, Father.
For Lord, that we continue to worship you, God,
Heavenly
Father.
Yes.
Ask you now, God, that you forgive us of our iniquity, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
But there are some real on the law, Father. We've done some things that we shouldn't have done. We left undone things that you told us to do, Heavenly Father. But most of all, God, know that your word says, we confess our sin, your faith and justice forgives us, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Yes.
And we thank you for this day.
Thank you.
And Father God, we pray that you look upon the pastor and his wife out there.
Yes.
I'm not here this morning, but we know God, you will judge him. Continue to bless me in a special way.
Mm.
And Father God, we give you all the honor, the glory, and praise.
Yes.
These and all blessings ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Thank you. good. Oh, my God. Bless his holy name right now. Bless his name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, God, for being good to us each and every day. Oh, man.
Thank you.
Guess I need to take this off. Y'all I get used to going back and forth here, man. Oh, y'all tired of this COVID thing? Yeah, I know the feeling. All right. Our scripture this morning is going to come from Acts, the book of Acts, the 16th chapter. So if you could turn and stand with me, and we're going to read God's word this morning, written by Dr. Luke. Acts, the 16th chapter, when you have it, say amen.
Amen.
You still need a couple more minutes and wait up, Rick. I hear you. Acts, the 16th chapter, starting at verse 22. And I'm going to be reading from the New American Standard this morning. And the Word of God reads, "The crowd rose up together against them, and the chief magistrates tore their robes off them and proceeded to order them to be beaten with rods. When they had struck them with many blows, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to guard them securely. And he, having received such a command, threw them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. But about midnight," somebody say midnight, "Paul and Silas were praying," somebody say praying, "and singing songs of praise," say praise, "to God. And the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there came a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison house were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer awoke and saw the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, saying, 'Do not harm yourselves, for we are all here.' And he called for the lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. And after he brought them out, he said, 'Sirs, what must I do to be saved?'" The word of God for the people of God. To glory be God. We're going to have one more song now from our praise team. And after that, you all will have to suffer with me for a few minutes as we deliver the word of God this morning. Amen.
Behind me.
never leaving or forsaking us. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you, God. Y'all give God another hand clap. Thank you, praise team, for setting the atmosphere. We just thank God for letting him use you. Thank you for being obedient there. First, we give honor to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we greet you this morning. That name in which we have all joy. So we are thankful right now for our Lord and Savior. I want to honor our pastor in his absence, Pastor Goforth. I thank him for this opportunity. And we pray that he's having a joyful vacation there. For those who are unaware, I know we got some folks online, so I guess last night Dad was asking me about the program. He said, do you have an intro? I'm like, no, I'm home. You know, there's no intro of the speaker. So I'm home, but for those who don't know, I am Reverend Rick Zimmerman, a son of the Mount. And we bring you greetings this morning from Kingsport, Tennessee, where me and my wife, Ida, who has infiltrated the choir this morning. God, glory for her, but we're just so thankful to be here this morning. It is good to be home. Good to be home and good to see you all. I'm even with the mask on. It's still good to look in your eyes. Still good to look in your eyes. All right, so this morning I pray that I won't be before you long, but we do have a word from God in this preaching moment, this opportunity here. From that word that was read earlier, I want us to focus on that 25th verse, that 25th verse that reads to us, but about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns of praise to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. The prisoners were listening to them. At midnight, they were singing. Pray at midnight in a prison. I'm about to start preaching over it. Okay. For a couple minutes here, I would just want to come from a subject and a topic of directions for your deliverance. Directions for your deliverance. We've all found ourselves in situations we are unable to get out very easily. Most of us are probably going through something right now that we need a break from, that we need to get out of, let go and release. It could be as simple as a little character flaw, or just a bad habit. We all got them. A bad relationship, a major addiction, or just this world in general. We need rescue and redemption. We need deliverance. The Evangelical Dictionary of Biblical Theology gives us two Greek words used for deliverance. The first one is roamahi. That means to rescue. And the other, exaero, means take out of. Rescue, take out of. Which are the most often used in the New Testament to reflect the ideal of deliverance from danger or distress. And I like this. It says that God is always the subject, while his people are always the objects of deliverance. That's powerful, y'all. I believe it's important for us to understand as we go forward that should help us in understanding and prioritizing our wants versus our needs. Because of who God is, if we just think about what we just said, God will give us what we need for deliverance. Because we are the objects of his love, we are going to receive all that we need, plus some on top of that. What we want deliverance from And what we need deliverance from, however, could be two different things. You all seasoned saints in here. I know y'all at the mount. Y'all been on this walk a long time, long enough to know there is a distinct difference between what we want and what we need. And we must be cognizant in distinguishing the want from the need. On top of that, we better be careful of what we want, because God may just give it to us, even if it ain't what we need and good for us. Look, if we're honest with ourselves, even though we don't need some things, we still want it. And there's some things that we want, that we need, that we don't want. Yeah. Y'all look lost there. Let me give you some examples. You may want currency, but what you need is character. You may want money, but what you need is mercy. You may want wealth, but what you need is wisdom. You want recognition, but what we need is reconciliation. You want gold, but what you need is goodness. You want silver, but what you really need is strength. You want greatness, but all you need is his grace. You might want to knock somebody out sometimes, but what you really need is some kindness. You may want position, but what you really need is patience. You want a comfortable lifestyle, and there's nothing wrong with that, but what you need is a closer walk with God. We all want satisfaction, but what we all need is salvation of the Savior. There is a difference between what you want and what you really need. Oh man, so we must be careful of what we want for deliverance and understand what we really need for deliverance and what we need deliverance from. When it comes to the demonstration and distribution of God's blessings upon us, what we need is central and essential. The need is the importance. Hence, we must ask God to help us understand those things we really need, because that's what we can count on happening. Philippians 4:19 tell us, "And my God will supply all of your needs according to the richest riches in the glory in Christ Jesus." My brothers and sisters, it gets no richer than the salvation we have been given through Jesus Christ. Now, we know in life we're going to struggle. It's going to come. But my pastor always reminds us, it's not that we struggle, but it's what we do when we struggle. We just need to make sure that we struggle well. Struggle well, knowing that your deliverance will come when you battle a need. And today, I have an assignment of exhorting just a few points to help us from this word that gives us some directions for our deliverance. So this morning, we find ourselves in the book of Acts. This is a bridge between the Gospels and Paul's letters to the church. It is likely authored by Dr. Luke, whom we know as a companion of the Apostle Paul, and also the author of the Gospel Luke. It records the expansion of the early church, both geographically from Jerusalem to Rome, and secondly, demographically, as it shifts from being a predominantly Jewish membership to including Gentiles. That's what we get folded in, y'all. And it can be dated around A.D. 30 to 62, and it covers the events from the ascension of Jesus to the early ministry of Paul in Rome. And we notice some themes. We know that this one of the main themes of the book is the power of the Holy Spirit. We find the event of Pentecost in here. We find about the church and its mission and the reception of the Jews, of the gospel by the Jews and the Gentiles. And for us this morning, we see the missionary journey of Paul. So as we park here in Acts 16, we have two of God's missionary preachers, Paul and Silas, who find themselves in the town of Philippi while on Paul's second missionary journey. Now, if you notice here, reading through this chapter, that they, during their visit, there was no religious enthusiasm in the city at all. And I guess we can relate to that as we experience in our time today what seems to be a growing religious apathy in our society. One where professed Christians, me and you in the nations, have dropped from around 77% to 65% in the last decade or so. Paul and Silas, for them, there was no beautifully ordained and dedicated church sanctuary like we have today or any temple. Instead, after arriving in the town, they find themselves having a riverside revival as they are supposed to be looking for a place of prayer, but there is no house of prayer because they didn't even have 10 Jewish men to organize a synagogue. So they sat and began ministering with the women who gathered. Ah, that sounds familiar too, huh? Oh, I tell you what, it sounds like another resemblance of the day as we got a lot of our women leading our households to church. Kudos to you, ladies. Kudos to you. But the men, we're going to step up. But they did not need a building or a chapel. We see them turning every corner into a pulpit, and transforming every house into a house of prayer. Yes, yes. It is in these settings that they expounded the good news of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And it was here that the Lord opened the heart of a woman called Lydia, who led her entire household to Christ. That includes not only her family, but her servants and associates. And now she offers her home as their place of prayer. While en route to the house, they encounter a slave girl, demon-possessed, being exploited by her owners for profit because of her fortune-telling. The apostles do what they do best. They heal the girl. But in essence, they destroy the profit of her masters, killing their business. So not going over well with the owners, they in turn seize Paul and Silas, drag them before authorities, inspire the crowd against them, and the two preachers are stripped, beaten, and thrown into prison. Prison for being Jews, throwing the city into confusion. Have y'all caused any confusion lately? Huh? Oh, we've been quiet. Have we caused any confusion lately as a body of Christ? Oh, my, I tell you. But, like I said, now, of course, Paul and Silas, even though they were considered jailed for being Jews, they themselves were born Roman citizens. So they are not Jew. Here come another nugget for you. Remember, you are always going to be associated, identified with those that you associate with. You better watch the company you keep, people. Watch the company you keep. So here now is Paul and Silas, bruised, battered, locked away in a city prison, along with their wants, as admirable as they may be, to minister and witness to the city of Philippi. Those have now been put on hold, or even dashed, or so it seems. Y'all know God has a way of working things out. In unpleasant and undesirable conditions, they will find hope and needed deliverance. And we are going to see the directions for your deliverance laid out here in verse 25 this morning. First, the direction for your deliverance begins with prayer. Begins with prayer. Now about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying. Any and every journey begins with the starting point of prayer. The word tells us they prayed. At midnight, Paul and Silas prayed. Here in a dark, dirty dungeon of a prison, they prayed. After being beaten and their feet fastened in stocks as an extra security precaution and further punishment, they prayed. Not complaining or calling on God to judge those who wronged them, they prayed. At their darkest moment, Paul and Silas were not weeping and having a pity party. They prayed. What is your first response when life seems unfair? People falsely accuse you. Others join them in condemning you without even hearing from you. And others lock you out. What is your first response when your hands and feet feel tied and you can't move or escape a world that is beating you down? What is your first response? Do we take pity on ourselves? Do we go after for revenge? No, what we need to do is pray. Paul and Silas found themselves physically restricted, but their hearts remained open to the Lord. Yes, yes. Most of the time, our only restrictions are ourselves. Yes, amen. And within, when something doesn't happen immediately for us, we get frustrated. Amen. Don't get worried when God doesn't answer your prayer immediately. Right. Prayer delayed is not prayer denied. You must know God has not forgot about you, beloved. Scripture tells us to pray. Pray without ceasing. 1 Thessalonians 5:17-18 says, pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God for you in Jesus Christ. Pray without ceasing, church. Keep on praying. Pray until it hurts. Pray until you cry. Pray until your earthquake comes. Pray. Trouble in the home. Pray. Marriage in trouble. Pray. Death robbing your family. Pray. Children out of control. Pray. Health is not where it ought to be. Pray. Finances are a little slim. You got more month than you got money. Just pray. You struggle to overcome an addiction. Pray. People tell you one thing and they do another thing. Pray. COVID just keeps coming back. Pray. Storms keep rising in your life, but all you got to do, people, is pray and wait on God. And here is another key. Paul and Silas were confident in their prayer. They were confident in their prayer because of their personal relationship with God. Deliverance is personal, y'all. Look at both of these characters here, Paul and Silas. Earlier I said they were both Roman citizens. They weren't Jews. But they both were saved. Paul's journey to salvation, we are well aware of that. When he was on assignment himself to persecute the believers of Christ. We know that while on that journey, he experienced Jesus on the Damascus Road. He was blinded and heard a voice from heaven cry, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Some translations record his response as, "Lord, what will you have me to do?" Paul can tell you that he had a personal relationship with the Savior. He would begin his missionary journey, and on one of them, he meets Silas. As Paul preaches and teaches to him, Silas accepts the Lord as Savior and becomes a convert for Christ. So they both have a personal relationship with Christ, with the Lord. They were saved believers, born again, represent the interest of the kingdom, stood up for God in Christ, and preached the good news of the Savior of the world. If you want deliverance, you need to check your relationship with Him who can deliver you. It is imperative for you to be able to confidently say that God is my Father, Jesus is my Savior, Savior. The Holy Spirit is my comforter and my teacher. If you can't say that, you need to check your relationship. There is nothing like knowing Jesus for yourself. You know him and he knows you. When I was looking up deliverance in my study, I got all the software that I pull all the stuff from. And upon searching, it brought up a lot of different resources, usually. Biblical dictionaries and encyclopedias to look at and compare. One of them was the New Knaves Topical Bible. And it didn't give me a definition. It did not give me a definition for deliverance. But it gave me some alternative references and lookup items. One of them said, see, prayer, comma, answer. See, prayer, answer. I'm going to say it again. Y'all going to get it eventually. See, prayer, answer. Somebody going to start shouting soon. See, prayer, answer. See, prayer, answer. Paul and Silas prayed. And what happened? God answered. You want your deliverance? It's in your prayer being answered. They prayed and God delivered. Part of the reason we are not experiencing our needed deliverance is because we are not praying. We are not taking advantage of the personal relationship that we have with God. I thank God for the privilege of prayer. I thank God somebody at some time prayed for me. But more importantly, I'm thankful I don't have to depend on them to make my personal relationship with God continue to grow. Some of us need to say thank you to those prayer warriors who are lifting us right now. Be grateful they're going to lift you. And you can count on prayer being made fervently for you by the church of God. But it is up to each and every one of us to cultivate a personal relationship with God. It is in that communion, that fellowship, that relationship that God will give us deliverance that we need. Prayer is personal. Deliverance is personal. The first direction for your deliverance starts with prayer. Pray. All right, next, after starting with prayer, next thing we see in that same verse, now about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and finished that off and singing hymns of praise to God. Hymns of praise to God. After prayer comes praise. Praise, regardless of your circumstance. They prayed and praised God. Again, thinking about the unfair, the inhumane conditions that they find themselves, Paul and Silas not only prayed, but they praised. Yes. Not whining, yes, or complaining, all right, or moaning about the pain they must certainly be experiencing. Yes. Instead, they are singing hymns of praise. Yes. We've got to praise no matter the circumstance. Amen. Praise even when it's midnight. Midnight. Yeah, I was reading that and this took me back to my youth. Took me back to my younger days when I was at the house with Barbara and George. And you know, got a little older and wanted to be getting out some. And with her, I would have negotiations about the curfew. Well, it wasn't negotiations, really. I ain't never won nothing of that. But, you know, you always wanted that extended time. You know, to me, you know, many, I know the party don't start till after midnight. Midnight is when everything start happening. But I wasn't having that at Barbara's house, no. She tell me nothing good happens after midnight. Nothing good happens after midnight. I am far removed from my midnight days of hanging out. These days, my midnight songs are a lot different than what they used to be. Midnight these days is usually not an easy time. Midnight
is when trouble may stir your heart. Midnight is when the circumstance of your problem can hit you with the most pain. Midnight is when you're experiencing the darkest moments of your situation and you can't see a way out. While midnight, that time when you are deep in the midst of your problems, may not seem like the best time for a sacred concert, we must know and be thankful that the God we serve does not shut down at 11:59 p.m. The great theologian Charles Spurgeon is quoted as saying, "Any fool can sing in the day. It is easy to sing when you can read the notes by the daylight. But the skillful singer is he who can sing when there's not a ray to be read, light to be read by. Songs in the night only come from God. They are not in the power of man." Let me ask you right now, church, can you praise him at your midnight? When you can't see how you're going to get through, can you still praise him? Can you praise him when you can't trace him, but you know you can still trust him? Can you praise him at midnight? Oh, I can imagine them in there singing those songs of praise. I can hear Paul saying to Silas, do you remember, Silas, that good old Psalm 46? Oh, God is my refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. I can hear Silas say, oh, I hear you, Paul. That sounds good. But do you remember that good old Psalm 27? Oh, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Oh, and I can hear Paul say, yeah, I'm with you, Silas. And then I can hear the prisoners. But you know, back then, y'all know how we were back in the day. We all we had was a clap and a stomp. So I can hear the prisoners joining in with a little clap and a stomp. And Paul and Silas going in a little duet on Psalm 121. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills from which cometh my help. My help, my help coming from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. Oh, he that will keepeth me will not slumber. Can you trust him at midnight, church? Are you there at midnight? Oh, can you praise him when you're going through? Can you praise him at all times? Knowing that he's always there. At midnight, they praise him. Only God can give you what you need at midnight. Only God can get you out of that cell at midnight. Only God can break down walls and barriers when it's midnight. Only God can restore relationships when it's midnight. Only God can change hearts that are filled with hatred when it's midnight. Only God can comfort you when you've lost the closest person you know at midnight. Only God can heal you when the doctor says, I've done all I can do at midnight. Only God can carry you through midnight. But we must be willing to praise and thank him through it all. Thank him for his salvation. Praise him for the privilege to even suffer in his name. Praise him for his presence as he strengthens and sustains us through suffering. Praise him because he is simply God and God alone. Praise him. Praise him. All right. Let me get out of here. My mom done told me if I'm up here too long, I'll be here by myself. So let's go on to point three. She made me throw out 2 pages. So we've got to pray. We've got to praise him. And thirdly, we're going to see a little something about position. Now about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns of praise to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Yeah, we must be in a position to hear from the Lord. We must be in a position to hear from the Lord. We should always be available to God. All right, there's some people like, you need to move on from that, Rick. Even though we may not be available to him, let me assure you one thing. God is always available for us. Always available to us. But unfortunately, too often, we must find ourselves locked in circumstances that we can't get out of before we make ourselves available to him. We must also remember that you're always in a position to bless somebody else. The prisoners were all in jail for various reasons. One thing we know, they were not thrown in jail with Paul and Silas because they were evangelizing, removing demons, performing miracles, or saving souls. We don't know their record, haven't seen their rap sheet, but it is safe to say that most were in there for legitimate reasons. But despite the reason, they were still in position to receive the word.
Amen.
Y'all, too many times we overlook those who ain't like us, who we don't think good enough. Too often we overlook the least and the troubled, thinking they don't deserve this. But no, those are the opportunities we need to be taken to witness. Those are the opportunities we need to be taken to grow the kingdom. We need to realize that we are always in a blessing position. Paul and Silas came with a desire to witness and bring good news to Philippi. But God said, I got a new plan. That jailer became the prime target for God's handiwork. I can't tell you all that was said in Paul and Silas' prayer, but I'm sure it was similar to what we all dedicated servants of God would ask. God, strengthen me and help us. God, forgive those who persecute us. God, use the suffering to teach others for Christ. Yeah, I know y'all sing that. Y'all say that prayer all the time. If Rick was locked in there, I know my prayer might have been something like, God, release these chains so we can get up out of here and go bless the people as we want it to. The chains would be off. The locks open. And y'all, Rick out the door. But God said, I'm going to deliver you, but not for what you want. I'm going to deliver you so you can give those prisoners what they need. I'm going to deliver you so you can bring salvation to a dying world. The prisoners, the jailer, and the jailer's family received the Lord and were immediately baptized. The jailer felt that he was in a hopeless situation. And you can see him in the feelings of many around us today. Those of fear, helplessness, and insecurity. As these seemingly insurmountable circumstances come up, there are two ways that a person can go. They can either draw closer to God or pull farther away from him. I don't know about you, but my choice is to have God's help and security. My choice is to rely on him who is worthy of my prayers. My choice is to choose him from whom all blessings flow. My choice is to trust him whose wisdom is infinite. Oh my God, we need to make sure that others make that same choice. Paul and Silas, while in prison, still shared the gospel of Jesus. We too, regardless of our circumstance, our situations, our surroundings, are to be in position for God. So today, if you want deliverance, pray and praise him. You want deliverance, be in position for him. Know when you pray to him, your cries won't go unanswered. And when your praises go up, your blessings come down. Ah, and when your deliverance comes, it blesses not only you, but those positioned all around you. Directions for your deliverance are to pray, praise, and be in position. I pray, cultivating a personal relationship with God. Regardless of your circumstances, you are to praise. Position yourself to hear from the Lord. And remember, you are always in a position to bless somebody else. Can somebody praise him right now for what he's done in your life? Can you praise him for the fact that you're here right now? Can you praise him for the fact that you got the right to everlasting life? Can you praise him that he saw beyond your flaws to provide your every need? Can you praise him that you're in your right mind? Can you praise him? Can you praise him? Somebody praise him right now. I tell you what, praise is what I do. Praise is what I'm gonna do. Praise, because I wanna be close to him. Praise all the day long. Praise when I'm happy. Praise when I'm sad. Praise when I'm up. Praise when I'm down. Praise to the good. Praise to the bad. Praise him just for being God. In everything that we go through, praise God. Praise him. And whom all blessings flow. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Thank you. We come now, Father, just thank you for this word. We thank you for pouring into the hearts of your people, Father. And we pray right now that it would not fall on soil, Father, that is rocky, but fertile soil, Father. We go out and be the saviors, the servants that you called us to be, Father. There may be some right now who are seeking that savior, seeking that deliverance. If that is you, please come forth. God is waiting for you. Know that we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. None of us are righteous, but we know that the wages of sin is death. And it is our desire that you receive the greatest gift God could give you. And that is the gift of eternal life through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So today, if you don't know that you have that deliverance, I pray right now that you would just lift these words of prayer. Today I accept that gift and confess with my mouth, Lord Jesus. I believe in my heart God raised him from the dead. With my heart, I believe unto righteousness. And with my mouth confess unto salvation. I receive him today, knowing he hears and accepts me. Because whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. We thank you, Father, for some that might have been saved just now. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. There may be somebody out here who has not received God. We want you to come right now. Come right now. If you know that you have not received God, if you can't be sure of your eternal salvation, we want to meet you at the altar right now. Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Mount Zion.